Thank you. Next item is to convene a Mesa City Council study session. All of our council members are present. The first item is to review items on the agenda for the September 12th regular council meeting. So please take a look at that agenda. Items one and two are just approving minutes and getting the meeting started. Items three are various liquor license applications. Four are various purchase contracts. Yes, Mr. Thompson.
On item 4C, and it's not so much an issue with the contract itself, but rather the council report. And when I went through the council report, and you see the vendors that came in with their pricing, and then at the very end, they have the base bid, and then they included an extra work and service call at another $14,000, which made it a total of $28,532. And that, I'm curious if the other vendors were also adding an extra work and service call, and if they did, what were those amounts? Because it's not showing, it's just giving us the total that the bug off pest control came back with, but I don't know if the others were able to provide that extra work, and if they did, what was their numbers?
Thank you. Our expert from purchasing will answer, has that on the tip of his tongue, I'm sure.
My name is Matthew Bauer. I'm the purchasing administrator. Mayor, Councilmember Thompson, we did look at the extra work costs. We took a usage on the extra work over a year's basis and then applied that across the board. And Bug Off was still the lowest price provider at $28,550. The next lowest was at $30,298, and then $40,186. $35,776 and $43,848. So Bug Off is still the lowest price provider, and I agree we should have that identified a little bit better in our council report, and we'll look to do that in the future.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you, Council. Thank you, Matt. Council, any other questions on agenda item four? Agenda item five are various resolutions. Six is the introduction of ordinances and setting a public hearing for those. Yes, Mr. Luna.
Mayor, I just had a question on the reverse auction. I thought that was intriguing and how that happens, but I can't remember which item it was. I remember reading the agenda.
Matt, can you come back up?
Field purchases.
So you just explain how the reverse auction works.
Sure. All right. Mayor, Councilmember Luna. The reverse auction, essentially, if you think about a traditional forward auction, is something similar to like eBay, where you have one seller and you have multiple buyers bidding up the price. A reverse auction is obviously the opposite of that, where you have one buyer and you have multiple sellers bidding down the price. And so it's a relatively new type of procurement that we've been doing here at the City of Mesa, but we've seen very good success in doing those in the past. And so we saw the gasoline and diesel fuel as being a very good opportunity, and so we attempted doing a reverse auction for the first time on fuel, and we ended up seeing a decent savings through doing that. And so it's something that you'll be seeing a lot more in the future, because we really believe that it's going to have a lot of good benefit for the city and hopefully drive down costs considerably.
So Matt, it really works best when you know you have a variety of different vendors who can provide that same product.
Correct. So the ideal solution is having some kind of commodity-based item that multiple sellers can provide, because if it's a commodity-based item, you are able to identify exactly what you're looking for, and then multiple providers are providing the exact same product. That way it comes down to strictly price that you're looking at when you're competing against vendors. So when there's quality issues or quality comparisons between two different products, and you're having them compete on price, it makes it more difficult. But when you're looking at things like gasoline and diesel fuel, since it's a straight commodity, it makes a really good sense to do it as a reverse auction and try to get that additional competition. All right.
Thank you. Yes, Mr. Thompson.
Chris, can we also look at doing the exact same thing with the aviation fuel, especially when we start looking at Falcon Field and as well as our helicopter, PD's helicopter, the air unit, locking in fuel rates I think would give them a better feel for their budget.
We could definitely look at that. So we're looking at pretty much every opportunity that we can take to utilize reverse auctions, because we've seen very good success in the past in utilizing them. And if there's any ideas, by all means, we'd love to take a look at it and see if it'd be a viable opportunity. But I think you're right with the aviation fuel. It has a very good opportunity to potentially see some great savings in doing it.
Yes, Mr. Richens.
Are we able to make the same adjustment for local vendors as far as taxes go? You know, when we do bids on items, and you know, we have a sales tax adjustment for local procurement. I noticed Synergy was the one Mesa company, and I'm not sure what the taxes look like on local.
Correct. So the system that we utilize, it's called it's EASI, or they say EASY. But the solution is very dynamic, and one of the things that we had when we set up to get a reverse auction platform was the ability to have that Mesa consideration be able to be calculated dynamically through that reverse auction solution. And this is probably one, if not the only, providers that has the ability to do that. So yes, that is definitely a possibility and able to be done when doing our reverse auctions.
Excellent. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Mr. Finner.
How about for new vehicle purchases, all these Tahoes, those kind of things? I could see how that maybe can be put into a category of a commodity.
Absolutely. And what we'd like to do is just kind of take a look at the opportunity. And one of the things that we do whenever we do reverse auction is we also speak with the vendor community to kind of gauge their interest in utilizing reverse auction. And with our provider EASI, they actually do a market study to try and help find and get buy-in from the vendor community, just so that they understand what a reverse auction is, and so they're not confused or don't want to participate. So in using them, we've been able to increase the amount of competition that we've seen in the past through these types of solicitations. So we can definitely take a look at that opportunity as well.
Thank you. Mr. Luna.
Thank you, Matt. I appreciate that you're looking outside the box in terms of how we do purchasing here in the city. So thank you for your efforts, and hopefully we can look at other areas.
Absolutely, and I invite anyone to come and test and check out a reverse auction that we're doing. It's actually a pretty interesting thing. You know, I kind of say it's about as interesting as purchasing gets when it comes. But it's actually pretty fun to watch. So if any of you guys would like to see a future one, I invite anyone to come down. It'd be great.
Put on the big screen.
Yes, there you go. Channel 11. That's the next reality show. So Matt, we'll follow you home.
So, Mayor, why Matt's here? It's a good opportunity. Matt, tell them about your award that you have.
Oh, yeah. So our office has been fortunate enough to be awarded several different awards. This year we got the Achievement in Excellence in Procurement for the 13th year in a row. We got our first time, which is the OA4, the Outstanding Agency Accreditation or Achievement. Outstanding Agency Accreditation Award and the Sterling Agency Certification Award. So we're one of three agencies in the country that have all three awards currently out of, I think, 13,000 different member agencies.
Wow. They're doing good work.
Thank you. Yeah. Well, that's a big deal.
With as good a job as they do, we should have no budget shortfalls, right?
That's right. That's right.
Well, congratulations, and thank you. Thank you for raising the question, Mr. Luna, I believe it is. Thank you. Thank you. Any other questions, gentlemen? Okay. Continuing to work our way through the agenda, items 5 and 6.
Mr. Richens? Quick question on 4J. Fiber optic expansion, is that getting trenched underground, or is that just stringing it on poles overhead? How does that technically work? Just curious.
Beth, thank you for coming forward.
Good morning. We underground most of this. This program was part of our last public safety bond election program, and we've been connecting different sites bond election was approved. And it's one of our final sections of line, but the majority of this is underground. We only have one location where we're going overhead up a small mountain that has an overhead pole, a small hill that has overhead poles on it.
Is that going conduit? Are you putting conduit underground?
Yes, we do.
And the asphalt cut and all that? I was just looking at the price, and it just seemed really reasonable.
Well, this is actually the the construction manager at risk contract. So this is the very first contract we do with a construction manager at risk, which is just to do the pre-construction services. The guaranteed maximum price will be coming later.
Okay. All right.
The warm up.
Thank you.
I wondered when the last time was we bought anything for $36,000.
I'm like, you must have had purchasing run that.
Yeah, we did a reverse auction.
That phrase is going to come up a lot, isn't it? Agenda item 5.
Two elections.
Various re-elect. Yeah. Is the election? Is it too late to do a reverse auction on the election? Okay. Just kidding, Mr. Freeman. Welcome. It's going to happen. I failed to acknowledge Councilmember-elect Mark Freeman. Good to have you here. Moving through this agenda again. Anything on agenda item 5, Council? Agenda item 6 is the introduction of various ordinances and setting September 26th as the hearing date. 5 is taking action on various ordinances, and 8 is various zoning subdivision plats. And so it appears everything is going to remain on the consent agenda. Is that the case, gentlemen? Thank you. All right, next item on the agenda for this meeting is to hear a presentation and discuss the findings and analysis of a blight study conducted on the proposed Southwest redevelopment area and provide direction on the creation of the Southwest RDA. I believe that sounds, well, we'll find out what that means, a redevelopment area, I'm guessing, and the expansion of Mesa's Central Business District. Take it away, Mr. Jebdiniak.
Good morning, Mayor. Good morning, members of council. It's good to be back in front of you this morning. Let me start with an introduction. To my right, Sarah Sorensen's our project manager leading this effort. Most of you have met with Sarah along the way. And to her right, Scott Ayet. Scott's with Zions Public Finance, our consultant to help with this blight findings and blight study and analysis. I'm going to turn it over to them in a moment. Two things. One, when we were back in front of you, I think it was February and March, you asked us to look at two additional areas. And just to give you an update on those two, we are out to an RFP. They are expected to be back, I think, the end of September 29th, if I remember correctly. So we'll be coming back to you with those here in the coming months as we go forward and look at those two additional areas. And the other point I wanted to make, this expansion of the Central Business District and or the new redevelopment area does not affect Downtown Mesa Association. The DMA area stays the same. This is really for us to now look at taking these tools and how do we utilize it in addition to downtown, how do we utilize it in other areas of the city going forward. So with that, I'll turn it over to Sarah.
Good morning, Mayor and Council. My name is Sarah Sorensen, and I'm the project manager who is leading this effort to create a new redevelopment area and expand our existing central business district. As Bill just mentioned, our main goal here is to secure additional economic development tools to help us with our business attraction and retention efforts while also eliminating blight. We are looking at multiple areas in the city to do this process, but we're going to start with the southwest area of Mesa, better known as the Fiesta District. So just to refresh your memory, a redevelopment area is an area designated by City Council to be in need of revitalization. The formal designation is a necessary step for adding additional economic development tools like the government property lease excise tax or the GPLET. The GPLET reduces a project's overall operating costs by replacing the property tax with an excise tax. And we've found that when a GPLET is in both a redevelopment area and a central business district, it may qualify for an 8-year abatement of the excise tax. GPLET projects are quite common among Valley cities. In fact, we have developers visit us quite frequently looking for areas in Mesa where they can do a project and qualify for the 8-year abatement. So this map shows Mesa's existing redevelopment area in green, which is focused primarily in downtown Mesa. The blue outline is our proposed new redevelopment area called the Southwest RDA. And you'll notice that both areas have blue shading inside. This blue shading represents our central business district. We are asking council to approve two separate resolutions on Monday evening. The first would be a resolution creating the Southwest redevelopment area that you see in blue. And the second would be expanding our central business district. One of the requirements of a central business district is that it must be located inside of a redevelopment area. So if the first resolution to create the redevelopment area does not pass, then we will not go forward with expanding the central business district. And I also just want to add that when we expand the central business district, we'll also be including two small spots within the existing RDA that we believe were mistakenly omitted when the original designation was made. And this is just a technical change to sort of clean things up and have the areas match the boundaries. And lastly, you'll see a red rectangle overlapping parts of the Town Center redevelopment area. This represents the Love Your Neighborhood program. So this is a coordinated effort among multiple city departments to help reduce blight in certain areas of the city. As you know, establishing a redevelopment area, it's a very complex process, and luckily we are staying on track. In April, we secured our consultant. I actually have Scott Aylett with Zions Public Finance here with us today. In May, we conducted a very thorough parcel study of the proposed area, which Scott will review next. We've had one public open house in mid-August. We held it at the Fiesta District Police Substation, and it was very well attended with about 35 members of the community. This gave us an opportunity to answer any of their questions and help educate them on the process of establishing a redevelopment area. Where we are at right now in the process is the finding of necessity, and that's where we're asking you to approve the two resolutions. Based on the findings of our parcel survey, we believe that the proposed area does exhibit a predominance of blight. So we are asking City Council to adopt a resolution to create the redevelopment area, and then following that, extend the Central Business District. If the two resolutions are approved, the city and the consultant will begin drafting the redevelopment plan, and this will help us identify potential redevelopment projects in the area. Now I'd like to turn things over to Scott Aylett with Zions Public Finance, and he is going to give you an overview of the results of the blight study that we conducted in May.
Good morning, Council and Mayor. It's a pleasure to be here with you this morning to review the findings of our survey that was conducted recently. First and foremost, I want to state what a pleasure it's been to work with city staff so far through the project. They've been great to work with, and it's been a wonderful experience working with them so far. As Sarah mentioned, my purpose today is to review the findings of the parcel study that was conducted back in May and compare those with the statutory requirements laid out by the state of Arizona. Before I get into the meat and potatoes of my presentation today, I just would like to briefly review some of the benefits of these tools that the state of Arizona has provided for municipalities within the state. As Sarah mentioned, there aren't many tools for municipalities in Arizona, and so utilizing these two is a great opportunity to really encourage and provide for additional opportunities for development and redevelopment within the various municipalities in the state. A few of the specific benefits, the first being that by creating this redevelopment area, it puts the city of Mesa and this particular area within the city on the equal playing ground with other cities in the valley. As Sarah mentioned, some of these other communities already utilize these tools. If the city of Mesa decides to move forward with this project, you would level the playing ground and hopefully and optimally provide for additional development opportunities in the future. The second benefit of this is By creating a redevelopment area, it provides opportunities for the city, property owners, and developers to target various federal, state, and local funds to the project area. Some examples of other areas within the valley that have used these tools to great benefit include the Hayden Ferry Lakeside in Tempe, which used to be a fairly undeveloped area with some parking lots and whatnot, and now it's a very sophisticated multi-use development within the city of Tempe. Another is the Camden Copper Square residential project in downtown Phoenix, which used to be a mixture of light development and some vacant land, and now it's a very aesthetically pleasing, high-quality retail development, or excuse me, residential development within the city of Phoenix. And so those are just a couple examples of other communities that have used these tools to great benefit to their municipality. So we can see that by using these tools, it provides for additional opportunities down the road for new development as well as for redevelopment of these areas. So moving along, before we get in again to the meat and potatoes, we need to have a better understanding of what the legal definitions are and their legal requirements are for these redevelopment areas. So my first step will be to go through the state code or the statutory requirements to get a better understanding and kind of a foundation for those. After that, I'll just give a brief summary of the study area and of the survey that was conducted back in May. After that, we'll dive deep into the findings of the parcel study that was conducted. And then lastly, we'll compare that with going back to the statutory requirements, looking more specifically at that predominance definition and what other cities have done in the area regarding that stipulation within the statutory requirement. As Sarah mentioned, in order to exercise the powers of an RDA, Arizona law requires municipalities to adopt a resolution declaring a finding of necessity, finding that both one or more slum or blighted area or areas exist in the municipality, and that the redevelopment of that area or areas is necessary in the interest of the public health, safety, morals, or welfare of the residents of the community. Furthermore, the code specifically outlines what a blight area is, and the code, as you can see here on this slide, states that a blighted area is an area other than a slum area where sound municipal growth and the provision of housing accommodations is substantially retarded or arrested in a predominance of the properties by any of the following. And the code outlines 9 different factors that should be looked for. They include the dominance of defective or inadequate street layout, faulty lot layout in relation to size, adequacy, accessibility, or usefulness, unsanitary or unsafe conditions, deterioration of site or other improvements, diversity of ownership, tax or special assessment delinquency exceeding the fair value of the land, defective or unusual conditions of title, improper or obsolete subdivision platting, and the existence of conditions that endanger life or property by fire or other causes. So in our study, we looked at each of these different nine requirements and included those within the parcel survey that was conducted. My review of the blight findings will focus more on whether or not growth is retarded or arrested within the area, while looking at the local case studies will help resolve that question of whether or not there's predominance. So a brief overview of the study area, as Sarah outlined previously, here it's in red. The area includes about 281 parcels, which is about 616 acres. Of those acres, only 483 of those are associated to parcels, meaning they're non-road acres. This is about 0.96 square miles and falls within the requirements of the percent of the area of the city that can be included in these redevelopment areas. When defining the study area, special attention was given to avoid residential developments and focus more on commercial and retail developments that fronted these specific roads of Country Club and the Southern Ave. So we conducted an on-site survey of the study area back in May. A member of our team came down to train city staff on how to conduct the survey. The subsequent survey was conducted between May 17th and the 26th. Staffers had a form that showed each of the different blight factors with check boxes. As they would go through, they can mark the boxes for the factors that were found on the specific parcel. Now, we understand that some of the factors that were listed previously are objective, while others are more subjective. Understanding that, we took some measures to help maintain some consistency throughout the survey period. Some of those things that we put into place to maintain this consistency included the fact that all surveyors were trained together in one day and took part of a practice session as they went out and surveyed one specific area, the study area, together so they could get familiar with the process and they were there learning it together. For the remaining areas, teams of two went out and surveyed them together so that it wasn't just one person left to survey the area. You had a team to do it together. These teams took photographs of the factors that were found to help support the case, as well as the survey was completed in a relatively short period of time, so it kept that recency of the survey within their minds as they completed it. After the survey was completed, our team collected additional data from various sources, including the Maricopa County Assessor, Recorder, and Treasurer, as well as additional data was provided by the City of Mesa. Here's an example of the survey that was used, or the survey form that was used for the parcel survey. Fields in black were assessed by the city staff as they were out doing the on-site survey. After the completion of the survey, our team used the additional data sources that we collected and used those to evaluate those areas on this form that are highlighted in red. Based on the statutory blight factors, the on-site survey, and the subsequent data collected, we found that 147 of the 281 parcels were determined to have at least one of the blight factors. This equals about 52% of parcels and 62% of parcel acres. So keep those numbers in mind. We'll come back to those when we look at the other areas within the valley and see what they've done to determine whether or not there's predominance. Here's a map showing all of the parcels that were indicated of having at least one of the blight factors. You see some of the clusters more there in the central area as well as the long areas of Country Club Drive. Now we'll dive into more of the specifics of the blight factors that were found. In the interest of time today, we'll review the top four factors that were found, including improper or obsolete subdivision platting, deterioration of site or other improvements, the dominance of defective or inadequate street layout, and diversity of ownership. It's important to note that you can't necessarily go and add these percentages up and expect to get 100% because some of these factors could be found on multiple parcels. In our analysis, we found that many of those blight factors that were found were more within the objective factors listed by the state, these looking at diversity of ownership or improper obsolete subdivision platting. Those are more objective compared to the more subjective nature of looking at deterioration of site. So generally speaking, we found that the more commonly found blight factors were more objective in nature rather than subjective. In the following slides, I'll go through each of these four and look at them in more detail. So first, we'll look at this improper or obsolete subdivision platting. You might be wondering, okay, well, what do you mean by improper or obsolete? For improper, we looked at parcels with platting that was improper, meaning that it was likely a result of lot line adjustments or subdivision changes or any other changes that happened at the parcel boundaries over time by various property owners. And then looking at the obsolete nature, that was just anything that wasn't in current compliance with the current regulations set out by the City of Mesa. As you can see, we found about 23% of parcels had this blight factor, while 7% of acres had that factor. It's kind of a big divide because a lot of these parcels were small in nature, so they were counted in the parcels category, but because they were small, they don't make up a whole lot of the parcel area. Blight factors for this area were determined by a list of challenged parcels due to faulty lot layout, lack of access, or inadequate size, as well as visually surveying each parcel and making sure any parcels were excluded because of these improper or obsolete factors. Here's just a brief sample of one of the areas within the study area that had kind of this predominance of this factor. As you can notice, some of these parcels are relatively small in size. Some of them do not have the adequate width required by the city. Others are landlocked, and so if in the future development were to occur, some of these parcels could get landlocked and not necessarily have direct access to roads, and so those were included because of the obsolete or improper platting included there. Second is this deterioration of site or other improvements, which had about 22% of parcels and 44% of acres. One of the areas or factors that we used to help determine this was looking at code violations within the area. And compared to an area of comparable size, the Superstition Springs area, the Southwest RDA had about 27 more code violations per square mile than the Superstition Springs area. Other factors that we used to determine whether or not this blight factor was present included those listed on this screen. One of the most contributing factors to this was vacancy. We found that a large portion of these buildings within this area exceed the current vacancy rate of Mesa, which is at about 12%. A lot of these parcels were above 15%, which is about 25% higher than the current vacancy rate within the city. So this was a huge contributing factor for this particular blight factor. As I reviewed the findings and conducted our analysis, I found that the surveyors were very conservative in their findings. We didn't necessarily go through.
Can I ask a question, Mr. Richards? As you do that calculation, if you were to take out the corner of Elm School and Southern, which obviously is the worst of it, well, how does that change your numbers? Go back a slide.
Yeah.
Back. I hate to make you go back because, anyway.
This slide right here.
how does that percentage change if you take out the one site, which is the worst of the worst? We all have, it's all been a thorn in our side for years. So, is this really a district problem, or does that one site skew and make it look like there's a district problem?
Yeah, that's a great question, Councilman Richens. I'm not necessarily familiar how that would change the total percent for this specific category. That's definitely something that we can look at. But of course, as you include or exclude parcels, that's obviously going to change the percent. But I would be interested in seeing how that would also change if that particular parcel would be excluded. But at this point, I don't know how that would actually change the numbers offhand.
So, yeah, I mean, I think we really need to drill down on, is this a one parcel problem? I mean, I know that there's issues around just as any neighborhood, but I think that's going to be important to actually making an actual finding of blight.
Mayor and Council, and maybe you can go back a couple more slides to the pie chart so we have percent of parcels, because I think that really kind of shows where you see the 52%. If you take one parcel out there, you're still going to have on a percentage of parcels, you see.
Well, there's multiple parcels in that.
But there's only a few within this larger area. I mean, that's not, you're taking out a handful of parcels on that one corner as opposed to, the whole area. So I think, because I think the acreage, while it's a significant amount of acreage right there.
Right.
But in the larger sense of the total acreage of that, if you pull up the map of the whole RDA area, that one corner isn't. When you see that much area.
Right. No, that helps. That pie chart helps.
And then you see that it's 62%. So it's a very large on the acreage sides. It's a very large number. So it's not 12% of the area, I don't think. And that's why they look at both. So it's not where you take that out, it drops down to some phenomenally low number.
If you took out the Fiesta District, it'd make it.
And the state law doesn't state which one you need to use. That's why we use both to kind of give a better understanding. But let's see. As I was saying, as we analyzed the results of the survey, we felt that the surveyors were really conservative in their findings. They didn't mark every cracked sidewalk or broken parking spot or scrape of paint coming off of a building or every little crack in a window. They were very conservative in their findings. Moving forward, looking at the dominance of defective or inadequate street layout. So for us to analyze this, the factors that we looked at was whether or not the parcel was impaired, the access to the parcel was impaired by any physical obstructions. We also looked at whether or not the parcel had inadequate frontage. And then lastly, one of the biggest contributing factors was looking at the street traffic conditions, the level of service of the adjacent streets to the parcel. And anything that had a level of service of E or below was marked as blight. And just some characteristics of streets that have a level of service E, some of those characteristics include unstable flow, speeds that rarely reach the posted speed limit, and roads in which any incident will create serious delays. Then the fourth factor that we'll focus on today is this diversity of ownership. And for this, we looked at any buildings that were split among multiple owners. This was because if development's going to occur in the future and you have one building that has three different owners, it's split into three parcels, redeveloping that parcel becomes very difficult, trying to get accordance with all of the property owners and whatnot. So we looked at parcels that had this specific case.
Excuse me, Scott. Mr. Kavanaugh has a question.
And just to that point, it's more a comment or an example for my colleagues. I think this is probably predominant in older parts of the city, but there is a strip shopping center at Dobson and Baseline that ever since I've been on city council, people have been asking me why can't the city get it redeveloped into a nice site. And over the course of that time, that parcel's had a minimum of like 9 separate owners up to like 13. And because of the agreements they had, each owner, it's like a condominium development for businesses, and they had veto rights over their neighbors. And so it's created a real difficult challenge. And I think your surveyors found that again in this area because that was kind of a trend in building in the 60s and 70s for these strip centers where you have multiple investors coming together to do it. But later when they age and you need to reinvest, no one can come to any agreement on it and no one wants to spend any money.
Precisely, yeah. And here's an example of that here within the study area here at Southern and Longmore. You have this strip center right here that there are three parcels, two of which have one owner and the third is a different owner. And so again, if this is gonna get redeveloped, you run into those roadblocks of trying to come to an agreement on the future of that particular development.
I have a real quick question. Sorry, I wanna go back for a second to 3, the dominance of defective or inadequate street layout. And you said something about one of the things that you look at is if a major obstruction or something were to happen that would limit the flow of traffic, or if you change the flow of traffic. And I'm wondering, are we shooting ourselves in the foot sometimes by doing our traffic calming like we did? I mean, we spent a lot of money on Southern Avenue, narrowing Southern Avenue for traffic calming. Does that all of a sudden now kick that area into a service level E because we're limiting the flow of traffic in and out of the area?
That's a great question. I'm not necessarily as familiar with the traffic within the city of Mesa and the structure that had been done in the past for that.
Because I guess what I don't want to do is think that we're doing something great for the community when all of a sudden it's actually backfiring and contributing to blight.
I guess moving forward, looking at, again, this diversity of ownership, again, looking at this example of how that was split up among multiple property owners and how that can create problems moving forward in the future. The other factors that we won't dive into more specifically today, again, are more subjective by nature, looking at faulty lot layout in relation to size, adequacy, accessibility, usefulness, unsanitary or unsafe conditions, and then any existence of conditions that endanger life or property by fire and other causes. So these factors were found, not nearly to the extent of other factors that we've gone through to this point, but they definitely were found within the area to some degree. So now we'll go kind of back to the city or the state ordinance statutory requirements to look at, okay, so we found that there is blight or there are blight factors within the area. But now let's look at that second portion that looks at whether or not there's predominance of blight within the area. So we looked at 4 different examples within the greater Phoenix area and looked at how they determined predominance of blight. And the definition of predominance that was used varies greatly in these four different scenarios. The first being the North Mountain Redevelopment Area in Phoenix, which indicated 37% of parcels and had one or more violations, or six of the nine blight indicators were found throughout the study area. Flagstaff Redevelopment Area just indicated that unsafe conditions were found to impact approximately 45% of the redevelopment area, and 65% of buildings were found with structural deterioration. The recent Rio Salado Redevelopment Area in Phoenix didn't note any specific percentages regarding blighted parcels, only specifically noting that deterioration was found on a majority of the parcels. And then lastly, the Apache Boulevard Redevelopment Area in Tempe didn't provide any information about specific percentages used relative to the parcels within the study area. So as shown in this analysis, we found that a substantial number of blight conditions existed in the area, again, 52% of parcels and 62% of parcel acres. It is the opinion of Zions Public Finance Incorporated that the business, or excuse me, that the Mesa City Council could make a finding of blight in the study area based off of the analysis that's been performed to date. At this point, we'll entertain any questions.
Thank you very much, Scott. Mr. Cavanaugh.
More just a comment. I want to appreciate you on the thoroughness of the study in terms of being able to see how we would comply with state law on this. And from looking at your study, it seems to me that we certainly meet the criteria to be able to move forward with this. I also wanted to comment that I had also attended the public hearing that we had on this. The community members there, all of them were in support, which is unusual for community meetings. And it came from a variety of individuals. I appreciate the work that's been done, the time that it's taken, doing it right. As you know, we've been working with Mr. Jackson, who's here this morning with Fiesta Mall, and moving forward with this is a key part of the recipe for redevelopment in the area. But I really appreciate the work you've done. I think you survived devil's advocate challenge, I think, from the state. Should we move forward with it? And Mayor, I hope we do move forward with it Monday.
Thank you, Mr. Cavanaugh. Mr. Jevgeniak.
Yes, Councilmember Cavanaugh, thank you for that. I just wanted to reiterate, at that public hearing, approximately 35 people, right. Public meeting, I should say, about 35 people showed, and several of them commented about how happy they were, very happy that we were being proactive and trying to do something. And the second thing I wanted to mention, they asked the two most predominant questions were both at the intersection of Alma School and Southern, the Grace property and the Fiesta Mall, about what's going on at those two sites. So this is certainly a tool that helps us to get something moving at those sites.
Great. Thank you. If that concludes your presentation, we do have one request to speak. So I'd invite Mr. Richard Jefferson.
Well, I was going to ask a question, but go ahead and invite your speaker up while they're coming up.
Okay, thank you. So since council's done, we'll hear from the request to speak, and then we'll open it up for discussion among council. Mr. Jackson, please come forward. I has filed a blue card to speak. Mr. Jackson?
Yep, there's a mic right there.
We appreciate you, and we're familiar with you and why you are so interested in this process, but would you let the public understand that as well,
thank
please?
You, Mr. Mayor. Members of the City Council, I'm Scott Jackson, and I represent Verde Fiesta One LLC that currently own the Macy's building and the Dick's Best Buy building at Fiesta Mall. And over the last 3 years, I've been working most every day on the mall in one fashion or another. And as I look at the 9 points up here that you just displayed, I think the mall fits in each one of those 9 categories. As you know, the Fiesta Mall has been in decline for many years now. Occupancy in the mall is down to the low 20% level. And there is serious possibility, or I should say real possibility, that the mall might ultimately actually go dark, because we've seen it decline from 65% to the low 20s over the last couple of years. And so it is in a dire state at the current time. But the location and surrounding area and the investment of the stakeholders in the city of Mesa over the last couple of years has added new life into the area. and the strategic characteristics of the location of the mall are still as sound today as they were in 1980 when the mall was built. It's easy to dream about what could be there, and I've been working hard on it over the last 3 years, and it's easy to visualize 900,000 square feet of space there that's been totally rebranded and remodeled that would house multiple uses of retail and office occupants that would give new life and new meaning to that location, similar to what it was in the 80s and 90s. But it's going to take an enormous amount of money to do that as well. And where the economics, as the prices have declined in the area because of the current condition, to rebrand the mall is going to have to do it correctly, in my view, after the 3 years that I've spent studying it. It's going to need a total rework. You know, it's going to have a brand new identity, both visually and in terms of use. And so with that, I look at what the private investment is going to be in order to effectuate this change over the coming years. And I see that the city's role in that is basically, there's three options that you can do to help facilitate what's going to be needed to reposition the mall property. One is to eliminate the risk of entitlements and to streamline the approval process, and that, I think, is well underway, and the city's been doing a good job of that, and I want to thank you for the needs that we have had to date have been addressed quickly and, you know, thoughtfully, and we've worked well with the city in that regard. The second is to provide the infrastructure that is going to take to provide the backbone of the future users of all of those, all of that 900,000 feet, and that, with the Southern Avenue improvements and the fiber improvements and so forth, have gone a long way to fulfill those needs. But additional tools in order to be competitive with the other cities in the Southeast Valley, predominantly or particularly Tempe and Chandler, and I think Gilbert is contemplating it, and they are, it's a very aggressive tool, this giblet, that will come with the Southwest Redevelopment Area approval. So in order for us to have all of the cards possible to facilitate the repositioning of the mall to a new life and a new image and a new brand, I strongly urge you to support and continue on with your efforts to get the approval for this redevelopment area. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jackson. And thank you for your investment in our community.
Thank you.
You have the resources and the experience to do this, so we're excited that you're here and anxious to work with you. Council, I would like to open up for questions and discussions at this point. I'm happy to kick it off. I don't see a reason not to enthusiastically do this and to adopt the Southwest Redevelopment Area. The word blight, I think, sometimes has a bad rep, okay? It sounds, it's got some negative connotations to it, but really it's just a legal term of art that allows us to offer up what few tools that the state legislature has given us to redevelop an area. So really the question is, in looking at these various parcels in this part of town, is it, would this piece of property benefit from redevelopment tools? Mr. and Scott, I think you said earlier that there perhaps were two tools that were in play here, and GPLET, I understand. Is there anything in addition to GPLET that offering, that making this finding would provide to people like Mr. Jackson and to the city to assist in redeveloping the property?
So I was just referring to the combined use of the RDA with the GPLET in place. Yeah.
Okay.
Where you get that maximum of the 8-year abatement.
Gotcha. Okay. Yeah, I want to make sure I understood. It might be easy to look at this and to think, "Oh, wow, we're in trouble. This place is not a great place to start a business." But on the other hand, I think Mr. Kavanaugh will tell you, for the last few years, we show up every couple of weeks and we're cutting ribbons and celebrating, you know, 1,000 new jobs here and there. And it's never been more true than, I mean, location, location, location. This is really one of the hottest, most in-demand parts of our city, particularly right now. And the city's investment in the streetscape has borne tremendous fruit. So I'm nothing but very encouraged about this entire area and see this as a great opportunity to add some additional tools that we haven't had. It's surprising, frankly, that we've been able to do as well as we have without the finding of a necessity that would give us the GPLED opportunity. So I compliment staff for doing this in such a thorough way and enthusiastically support what we're talking about. So thank you very much. Mr. Richens.
Now, just kind of put a postscript on this. There's a couple others that you guys are looking at. Could you give us just a quick reminder about where those are?
Sure. The West Mesa proposed redevelopment area, request for proposals out. That basically picks up where this leaves off and goes north, if you will, is west of the existing town center redevelopment area. Vince, you show the map for me, Scott, if you would. And really goes from the west Tempe line from our western border all the way back to town center. So
you along Main Street?
Along Main Street, along University, along Broadway as well, and picks up some of the properties north of Southern as well.
Again, drawing out primarily residential areas?
That is a heavier residential area, and we will probably not avoid as much residential as we did with the southwest. And the second area is east of downtown, primarily along the light rail, but also picked up University and Broadway at the same time. So that's a little more of a spine going eastbound. But again, that's all subject to change. That's what we've proposed and put out for the consultants to look at and help us with the blade analysis. More to come.
Thank you. Any other questions, Council? The agenda item asks us to provide direction on the creation. Does this require a motion for direction?
It's going to be on the agenda, so we're good.
Gotcha. Okay, thank you very much. Good presentation. Next item is item 2B, to hear a presentation and provide direction on the following housing and community development programs. A, for the fiscal year 17-18 low-income housing tax credit and proposed timeline for review process. B, the proposed process on the timeline to update Mesa's housing master plan. And C, the options for how to invest fiscal year 15-16 community development block grant unspent and program income funds. Liz, welcome back. That's a lot to talk about.
And I will try to keep it very brief, since there are three items that we need to cover today. The first item for discussion is the 17-18 funding process timeline. Every year we come to Council to lay out the timeline for your approval. This year we have added an additional component to our timeline, which I will explain in a moment. As you know, we have an annual funding process in which nonprofits and developers submit applications for our human services and federal funds that we receive from HUD, which include Community Development Block Grant, CDBG, Home Investment, and Emergency Solutions Grant, which is the ESG program. This process is set up to be a competitive process with various reviews by staff, Housing and Community Development Advisory Board, and the Community and Cultural Development Committee, and ultimately awarded by the City Council. The Arizona Department of Housing, I will refer to as ADOH, also conducts an annual process to receive and review proposals for low-income housing tax credit, which I will share. When I talk about it, I'll use the term LIHTC. The LIHTC process is separate and distinct from the city's HUD program funding award process, even though some of the nonprofits and developers may also be awarded funds from the city, which is referred to as city contribution. ADOH may also receive proposals from projects with no city contribution. In those cases, ADOH will ask the city to provide letters of support for those projects. In preparation for the fiscal year 17-18 funding, we anticipate to receive level funding from what we have been allocated in 16-17. As shown in this chart, we expect to receive approximately $4.5 million in federal funds for the next year. As you will remember, earlier this year in April, city management came to council with a tight deadline asking for additional review of LIHTC projects, which did not ask for city contribution, but required letters of support. Through that experience, we determined it would be prudent to add a review process for these projects to ensure that ample time was given, that developers had a clear and efficient process for which they could come to the city, and that we had a coordination between city departments for any needs or requests made by the development team. As such, the recommendation is to request that all LIHTC projects in Mesa submit their proposals to the city through a coordinated process of review. Certainly, those requesting city contributions will have more to provide to evaluate their need for gap financing than those who do not seek any city contribution, but we would maintain the same timeline for both type of proposals. It is important to note that the city review process and timeline in no way affects the decision award of tax credits by ADOH, nor does it set any additional criteria in order to receive city support for a LIHTC project. As you can see on this chart, staff recommend that we announce our funding and our new process for submission of LIHTC projects with or without city contribution on September 29th with a due date of November 17th. I would like to note that last year, council approved an open application process for home funds should we not expend all home funds for LIHTC projects. We would like to continue that practice of maintaining it open beyond November 17 for any non-LIHTC projects seeking home funds for gap financing. The funding process for our other funding sources, which includes CDBG, home, and ESG, and our human services, would open on January 2nd with a submission deadline of February 6th. So as with this information, I ask for council if you would concur with the scheduled timeline proposed for the 1718 HUD and Human Services Program funding process, and whether you concur with the newly proposed process and timeline for LIHTC.
Thank you, Liz. Mr. Luna.
Liz, real quick, how do we not let potential applicants know that this is available since we've changed the application date?
Mayor and Councilmember Luna, we will have to get that out, the word out through, we have an interested parties list of developers that we've used in the past. We'll also put that on our website. It's not uncommon for developers to come and speak with us or work through other departments like planning, and so we will plan to make sure we share that information and get that word out.
Mr. Richens.
Yeah, I think as they do their due diligence, this should be a plenty of advance notice. And one of the big issues is notification to neighbors and helping people understand the multiple steps in the process. So we're not just having this big rush at the time when we do the zoning case or we do the letter. And so that way, you know, neighbors can have advance notice, they can work with the developers. I think we do a fairly decent job of pushing the developers into neighborhood groups to make them discuss the projects well in advance. But sometimes they move a little quicker than that. So I really like this timeline. I appreciate it. Notification of our potential developers sounds like you're across that and that we're in alignment with ADOH timelines as well. And I know that was the big trick. And it's been a squirrely 5 years on this, you know, trying to, you know, accommodate developers when they come in and they're not always have everything planned out well in advance. And so we try to accommodate. But I think this is really clear. It sets clear expectations. And a developer doesn't meet these timelines, the answer is no, I'm sorry. And so we need to make sure that we stick to these deadlines pretty firmly. It's important to the process with the public. And I think that's why we finally have settled on these timelines. So I appreciate the work that you've done for this and support this wholeheartedly. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Richens. Is that a motion?
Indeed it is.
Okay, is there a second? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, Liz.
Thank you.
So that takes care of item A.
Yeah, Mayor, just quickly, Liz, we should mention the council. I know we put it in the update, but we did provide some input on the criteria that have been used, that have been used in the past for determining the points. Yes. We try to encourage the consideration of other public transit services.
Yes.
But as I understand, Liz, correct me if I'm wrong, that the criteria did come out and they haven't changed. Is that
right?
Correct?
So they, what's called the Qualified Allocation Plan, the QAP, did come out, but it's during the, yesterday was the deadline for the comment period. So they will look at those comments and make adjustments to the QAP.
So, but we did provide our comments early on. So you know that's in there. Okay.
And the comments, I think, were consistent with things that have been discussed in our council meetings, which is so a little bit of frustration over the fact that you don't get any points unless you're a half a mile from a light rail route. And why don't bus routes and or, you know, 0.56 miles, why wouldn't those qualify? So hopefully those comments were well received, and we'll see to what extent they were persuasive. Great. Any other questions or comments about the first part of this presentation, Council? Thank you, Liz. Please continue.
Yes. So it wasn't long ago that in one of these study sessions, Mayor, you requested I return with a plan to update the housing master plan. After much research and seeking guidance from city management, I would like to present the plan and timeline for the plan. The purpose of the housing master plan is to provide a broad and comprehensive set of data related to housing inventory types and varieties all throughout Mesa, as well as policies to help City Council make informed and consistent decisions for housing proposals throughout the city on fact-based demonstrated need. Staff recommend that we approach this project in two phases. The first phase would be data gathering research, in which a consultant would be retained to research the current housing inventory and collect supporting information on the impact of housing development that has occurred in the last 10 years in Mesa. The consultant would also be tasked with providing projections on housing trends for the next 10 years. Once this information is gathered, the results would be presented to City Council and the community at large around December of 2016. In phase two, we would engage the community and develop recommendations for housing policy to be carried out for the next 10 years. The process will be inclusive of Mesa residents, professionals in the field of planning and development, and other disciplines. And once the recommendations have been drafted, they will be presented to City Council for direction, and we estimate that would be around April 2017. That's a very brief overview of the Housing Master Plan update. Is there any questions? And does Council concur with that two-phase approach?
Thank you, Liz. Council?
Yeah, I've heard hearing a lot about housing and pushback around housing around light rail, and you know, there's been planning that's been put in place over 10 years ago about when we did our West Main Street plan or Central Main plan, about how that was supposed to play out. Mm-hmm. And now we're starting to get proposals that match the mm-hmm. planning that was done all those years ago. And I think there's a disconnect between the demographic trends mm-hmm. that, you know, preferences of baby boomers and millennials and as they've been changing, and the housing stock that we have in mm-hmm. Mesa. And mm-hmm. we really need to get our heads around it. So right. I think the planning process is an important education tool, not only for the neighbors, but also to inform ourselves and the market what the opportunities are. And so I think this is a great timeline. I think mm-hmm. the public involvement is going to be key, mm-hmm. and I appreciate you guys baking that right into the process. Right. I think you're going to get a lot more than we've had in the past mm-hmm. on this one. Mm-hmm. And so I concur that this is the right process, and would, of course, motion to support you in doing that.
Thank you.
Mayor and Council, we felt like there's a lot of perceptions or assumptions about what it is that the inventory really looks like, and we thought that would be the first thing, the most important thing, that before we can really have some public dialogue, is to set the table correctly and identify what it is that's out there and what it looks like, and maybe begin to talk about, as Councilmember Richens talking about, what are the trends that match up with compared to what we currently have in the city with what we're seeing going on to the future. So we thought we'd start with that, and then we can bring the community in to get their input and vision about going forward.
Yeah, that data analysis and demographic trend going forward. We had a presentation at the Arizona League of Cities and Towns Conference mm-hmm. a couple weeks ago, that one of the real estate experts came and walked through that demographic change, and it was very mm-hmm. eye-opening mm-hmm. about the number of single and two-person households are like 75% of the market wow. by 2030 or something. And when I started calculating out my birthday and the age of my kids, mm-hmm. I was like, oh my gosh, that's me. Mm-hmm. you know, and so it was really interesting. And I looked around, and I know I'm not staying in my single family home with mm-hmm. I'm already tired of mowing the lawn. And I want to move into something more urban like that. And I look around Mesa, and there's no housing stock available
that would interest me right now in that context. And so it was just really interesting to sit through and look at those curves and what's happening. So hopefully this plan can really get out ahead of it. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't think this is actually requires a motion, but it does require direction, and mm-hmm. I concur with the consensus that you've been hearing. It is, as we all know, transit-oriented development is under intense pressure for low-income tax credit housing, mm-hmm. and as those projects have come up, it's been a little frustrating for me because it's really a broader policy mm-hmm. question. And I guess if I need to, I'll make that decision in the context of a specific zoning case, but I think it would be more useful to me, sitting in this position, to have a broader goal in mind. And certainly there is, I need to look people in the eye and tell them I'm not against affordable housing. Mm-hmm. I understand the importance of it, but it just needs to be in the right place, the right time. And so this will help me as a policymaker to respond better, I think, to those proposals as they come in. So I appreciate staff taking this on and look forward to, it's going to be a very interesting public engagement process. We've already heard the voices out there, and it'll be interesting to get them in a room and hopefully in a constructive way reconcile some of the different opinions that are out there. So thank you, and I think you can tell the direction is to please move forward.
Okay.
So please proceed with the rest of your presentation.
Sure. So the last item for discussion is to decide how we wish to utilize unspent prior year funding and program income. It is not unusual for us to have some funds that are unspent. We typically recuperate those funds and hold for the next funding year allocation. We also receive PIC program income every year, but it is really difficult to anticipate how much that would be from year to year because it does vary. Due to the larger than usual amount of program income and unspent funds, we would like council to consider allowing us to hold a special round of project funding, which staff recommend would be for the specific activity of public facilities and improvements. This past funding cycle, there was one project submitted by Child Crisis of Arizona that requested funding for a facility improvement, but the application didn't fully take into account some of the federal requirements like Davis-Bacon wages. We know that this project and possibly others could utilize our funding to make those improvements now rather than waiting for the fiscal year 17-18 funding. Council also has the option to roll these funds into the 17-18 funding cycle, which has been our past practice. However, staff would need to carefully monitor the funding ratio of expenditure versus cash on hand to ensure that we meet those funding deadlines and commitments that HUD puts on us. For this reason, staff recommend the option of opening up a funding opportunity for the public improvement. And based on that, we request your direction on one or of the two options.
So, Liz, what you're asking the council, one, to go ahead, we could allocate those dollars today to a mm-hmm. specific project.
Right.
Or we could hold on to those dollars and roll it into the larger pot in the Correct. Next cycle. But, council, one of our performance measures with HUD, mm-hmm. I guess, criteria,
yes,
is our spending ratios. They don't like it when we hold on to dollars. And so they'll look at that ratio of how much.
1.5.
Yeah, so if we have dollars that are sitting and not actively being spent down, mm-hmm. that can be that can go against us in future sure. allocations. So sure. we would be anxious if, you know, that would be why probably our first recommendation, if we have a project that we believe that would probably be funded in the following year, if they're ready to go now, it would help us meet the criteria, the spending ratios with HUD now. So that would be our first priority. Otherwise, we can just roll it forward and put in the larger pot with the next year's allocation.
And I'm sorry, I appreciate the clarification. I would add that we wouldn't be looking to spend all of it, only because we know that emergencies do arise with floods or unexpected events. So we'll still keep a cushion of money, but we just have such a large amount that we do want to spend down about 60% of that.
Great. Thank you. I know we do have some questions. Mr. Cavanaugh, then Mr. Luna.
Thank you, Liz. I appreciate the presentation and the recommendations. Particularly, I'm impressed with your attention to detail and making sure we comply with HUD requirements mm-hmm. because of challenges, you know, that we've had in the past, mm-hmm. which have had adverse impacts on us. And I think your leadership and your staff is doing a very good job there. I do like the idea of having supporting your recommendation for a special round of project funding. I do know that under your analysis, you will retain enough money to, as you say, for emergency purposes or unanticipated needs. So I appreciate the work that you've done, and I certainly support your recommendation.
Thank you.
Mr. Luna.
Vice Mayor Kavanaugh said it better. So I'm going to echo what he's saying. I think that we should go ahead and reallocate those funds. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, so just out of curiosity, if we did roll the money over, are we clearly then outside of the guidelines that HUD encourages us to be within, or is that kind of an subjective thing?
We're not in out of the line, but should we get additional program income or something else occur, that would put us in jeopardy.
Oh, the fact that we would get more money mm-hmm. from projects that are paying us rent mm-hmm. or selling something, that actually hurts us.
Yeah.
It's not good to collect money. I mean, collecting, it's okay to receive the money program income. It's better to spend it.
Right.
And it just, that ratio becomes very sensitive for us.
So what's the process that we would go through in determining how to allocate these excess funds?
So it would be a mini version of our regular allocation. It won't be as cumbersome as what we go through for the full funding, but we will put the notification out and ask for proposals and be able to bring those to you.
Thank you. Other questions or comments, Council? I think there's been a motion made and a second for the first option, which is to go ahead and allocate the funds now. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Liz. I think that concludes your presentation, correct?
Yes.
Next item on our agenda for this meeting is item 2C, appointment to the Self-Insurance Board of Trustees. Is there a motion? Thank you. A motion and a second. Thank you. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
That passes unanimously. Item 3 is information pertaining to the current job order contracting projects. Councils, any questions relating to those items? Seeing none, we'll move on to item 4, hear reports on meetings and conferences attended. Mr. Thompson.
Hunger Awareness Month kicks off September. And then also this past Monday, we had our beach bash out at Skyline Pool. Council members Kavanaugh and Luna joined me out there for a bit, and it was a huge success. We had roughly around 500 people that came out and enjoyed the free swimming and the free snow cones. Kids were excited. Hashtag best day ever. Heard that quite a bit. So a big thank you to Mark Hirschberg and to Mark Foote and his staff out at Skyline. So thank you.
That's great. Congratulations on it. I heard that was a great event. I will take the liberty of congratulating Mr. Glover. I know yesterday he received a great acknowledgement as a Flynn by the Flynn Foundation. So congratulations, that's well deserved, and we're looking forward to you continuing in your community service with that additional training and recognition. So congratulations, Councilmember Glover. Also earlier, I made fun of Mr. Freeman, and I'm sorry about that. I should have said congratulations to the winners of our city council election last week, Mark Freeman being one, and we appreciate Councilmember-elect Freeman being present and already being diligent in exercising his opportunity to serve on the council. Also, of course, congratulate Mr. Winkle for his success and wish the best of luck to those who are continuing, Ms. Allen and Mr. Whitaker in the ongoing election. Council, any other items under this? If not, we'll go to Mr. Brady for scheduling of meetings and general information.
Thank you, Mayor. Just a reminder, the 2016 season kickoff celebration at the MAC is Friday, September 9th from 6 to 10. It's a family-free, friendly festival with live music and entertainment. And then Saturday, September 10th, we invite you to join Vice Mayor Kavanaugh for a free pancake breakfast from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. at Fire Station 210, which is located at 1502 South 24th Street. Also a reminder that Mesa's Festival Forest is back at Pioneer Park every Saturday night, beginning at 5:30 till 9. And our next council meeting will be Monday, September 12th. Thank you.
Thank you. If there's nothing else, I'd entertain a motion to adjourn. Thank you. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned.